take two tracks and call me in the morning. It's the Spin Doctors. What do you think? Is that good? Is that a good intro for us? Is that good? I thought about that for a long time before. You have no idea, man. It honestly came shortly after I thought of the name. Okay. Well, I don't know if we're going to keep it. It's fine. Let's do it. Take two tracks and call me in the morning. It's the Spin Doctors. We're here. We are the Spin Doctors, baby. It's Rick Storer and Nick Malizia here to cure your musical woes with albums from past and present. I am Rick Storer, comedian, actor, podcaster, obviously. And I would like to welcome to the show my co-host with the mo-host. Give it up for Nick Malizia.
Yay! Is this
pepperoni pizza?
Is this where we put in the applause, right? Because all my fans are listening right now.
There's going to be, so much post-work where I'm going to add in applause and a different co-host. I don't know. We don't want to get aggressive right off the bat. That's not nice.
I'm not even halfway through my first White Claw. Come on, we gotta pace ourselves here.
No, you've got a whole hand of claws you gotta get through.
Rawr.
Right? Because
that's my Bear Claw White Claw
podcast where that happens. Bear Claw White Claw, rawr, baby. Where do we start? I thought this show is, I would say, my brainchild. Mm-hmm. It's my the offspring of my thoughts and prayers.
Foreshadowing,
I birthed it one night. Yes, absolutely. I birthed it one night while listening to an album we're starting off hot. This podcast is about music. So basically, I figured, everybody has that album from their past.
Yes.
Or some album that they're, really fond of.
Mm-hmm.
That means a lot to them. And you have a lot of nostalgia for, or a lot of positive feelings for. And, maybe it's not your favorite album by your favorite artist or anything, but maybe it's just, it has a lot of memories or something,
Good or bad.
Good or bad, if you want to bring a dark stink of terrible memories around associated with an album. I know that I have a few albums that are that way.
Oh, indeed.
That I can never listen to again.
What is a song that you can't listen to anymore because of, I feel like typically it's like a breakup or something. It's like, what's just like a song, whether it's like a breakup or like a weird party thing or just like something was happening when that song was playing? And like forever, you're like, oh man, that time we were, in the backseat of the Camry taking shrooms, like now.
Oh, wow, you really know my life. I have a few songs like that. I'm pretty masochistic, so I'll still listen to those songs and just like cry over them.
Oh yes.
Like I still do that to myself. Or songs that just are about being sad, like The Night We Met by Lord Huron.
Oh,
you know, beautiful. That song?
Oh yes, big Huron fan. Freaking, because I've been at as I'm sure the listeners will find out over time. I used to be a wedding DJ, so I've heard many songs at good and bad moments and everything. But The Night We Met is a song that gets played for our first dance a couple times by the hipper couples, but like there's always like this like sense where like they're dancing, they're in love, you look around the room, you can see like the one person where it's like, this was our song, but then she didn't say she wanted to come to the wedding with me, and now I'm here alone.
This was our song. I have, oh man, all my exes, we always had, I have an R song for all of us.
Oh yes, yes.
I think the worst the worst our song, and it has nothing to say about the girl or anything, she's fantastic, but our song was the cover of Love Song by 311.
Oh I know. Oh yes. Yes.
That song, for some reason, was our song, and that played at, like, the dances we were at in high school and stuff, and so that was our song, and I heard it not that long ago, and I was, like, taken back. I was like, man, that used to be a song that really I would look at another human being and feel a physical and emotional connection to. And now I've been alone for so long, I can't imagine even touching another person. Without even being in quarantine. This could have been recorded 2 years before quarantine.
This is pre and post quarantine.
Yeah.
Oh, that is so funny, and I know exactly the song you're talking about, because I remember hearing that song, and at the time I was single and, like, you know, fantasizing, being like, someday I'm going to be able to have this be a song I can play for someone else. And that day hasn't come yet. I'm still waiting
to share
my 311 love song with a very unlucky girl.
That day will come.
She's like, this is how you're opening our relationship with a 311 song? It's like, yeah.
I just looked at you and I saw your energy, and it, amber was its color.
And the music video was so weird. They were like in a bar. Do you remember the music video?
Vaguely. I just remember it being like one of those videos from the late 90s or early 2000s that was just Vaseline smeared cameras.
Yes.
So it was just all dreamy the entire way.
Yes. Yeah, okay. And they're playing in a bar, and then like the singer sees a girl and like is singing it to her. It's like there's nothing that happens, but it's just kind of like one of those like early 2000 videos where it's like, you know, everyone, like the directors, there's like, all right, so this is how the video is gonna go, guys. You're gonna be in a bar. They're like, uh-huh, you're gonna be playing the song. Uh-oh, that came out of nowhere. And wait for it, there's a girl at the bar and the singer is singing it to her. I don't know how you come up with this. How?
You're a genius.
This is why they pay me the big bucks.
And I like the because that song is so, it's so, honestly, I mean, the original obviously is better. Like,
I'm losing the original. Who does the original? I'm losing that right now. I forgot.
I'm pretty sure it's The Cure.
Oh, and that's even, see, that's heavier. Yeah. Are you a Cure guy?
No,
but
that song is beautiful. I heard the 311 version first, which is why that was the, you know, version that was our song.
Yes.
And I didn't even know that it was a cover for a long time. And then when I found it out, I was like, oh, okay, well, this is way better. I mean,
yes.
No disrespect to 311. 311's a great band.
Yes. At least you weren't the guy that was like you heard the 311 love song, and then like one day you're like at a bar or something, and then the Cure version comes on, and you're like, no way, the Cure covered 311? And then everyone's looking at you, being
God,
like,
"That's the worst."
The worst.
I've had dumb moments like that. Like, for a while, I kept accidentally saying Billy Idol instead of Billy Joel, and so like, it's like I can't be like when Piano Man comes on, I'm like, "Oh, do I love Billy Idol?"
What I like is that like combine like. Mixing up the two, and like Piano Man comes on, and then in your mind you just have a shirtless Billy Joel just like with the leather fingerless glove being like, Piano Man,
it was
like
spiky white hair.
Sing me a song, Mr. Billy Piano Man. Oh man, that's funny. About a month ago, I was at work. I work with a lot of shitty high school kids, and this one girl, she's like the super like hip girl. She was like saying something, blah, 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 and over her be like, I've been going to Coachella since I was 7. And I was like, yeah, my parents go to Coachella every year and blah, blah, like already red flag,
wow.
You know, red flag. And so we
only the coolest people go to Coachella when they're 7.
Right. Yeah. But, but so we're talking about like concerts we've seen and everything. And then, we're like going back and forth. She goes, you know, I saw Billy at the Forum. And I go, you saw Billy Joel at the Forum? She goes, no, Billie Eilish. And I was like, oh my dear God. Like the biggest age gap show right there. I was like, oh God. It's like, first of all, she doesn't get the name Billy. She is not at that
she's
level.
She's not one name, no.
No, she's not the
but
Billy.
But then again, is Billy Joel the ownership? Does the ownership of Billy go to Billy Joel? Is he the biggest Billy?
I mean, I would like to say so, but because of the last name Joel, I would have to say he's the main BJ. I mean, come on.
He's the main BJ.
BJ and the Bear.
That's a reference I don't get. Is this an age gap thing too?
Oh, kind of. I don't know. Are you a fan of Minus the Bear?
I have listened to Minus the Bear.
So I'm not a fan, but I heard this story. I heard this story about how they got their name, where like there's this old TV show called BJ and the Bear that like all the band members watched. It's like this old 70s show or something. And one night one of the band members went on a date and came back the next day to band practice, and the guys were like, "So how was the date?" And the band member that went on the date was like, "I guess you could say it's kind of like that show BJ and the Bear minus the bear." I mean, come on.
It's a blowjob reference.
It's a blowjob reference.
Oh my god. Everything.
This song's so deep. We're out here.
I remember
here.
When
Ooh.
I found out that Pearl Jam was about cum. I was like,
wait,
okay, yeah, that
what?
Makes sense. But minus the bear.
I didn't know that.
What do you mean, what?
I didn't know that.
Are you serious right
yes.
now? Pearl Jam.
That is so filthy.
Is semen.
Wow.
Like a pearl necklace?
No, I got pearl necklace. Pearl Jam. Whoa.
Oh
that is
my
filthy.
God.
That is crazy. I don't listen to Pearl Jam.
This...
I've never had someone
no, I mean...
who knows Pearl Jam enough to be like, you need to listen to this or that. You know, I respect
See, this
them.
Is why I think that you're going to be fantastic like as a co-host. Like when I thought of doing this show, I was like, I got to get Nick. Because we have, I think, very like different... musical connections
yes.
and very different. I think that there's probably a lot of stuff that I've heard that you haven't, mm-hmm. and vice mm-hmm. versa. And so I think this is going to be
oh,
really,
yeah.
really fun.
I'm already learning stuff. I love this. I can't believe that.
Yeah, you're learning that Pearl Jam has come.
Wow. Huh.
This is, you know, if this podcast goes nowhere and nothing ever comes of it, just the sheer fact that I was able to educate you that there are like 50-something-year-old men going around on stage with a band called Come, and they're just like getting down and rocking the house. Like, that is enough for me, man. I gotta say, that's enough for me.
Oh my god! Now I'm like thinking, it's like, Daddy, like, why is your name Pearl Jam? Like having to tell their children, it's like, when you're older,
don't worry, don't worry about my band name.
Oh man, I love everyone from Pearl Jam. I just never listened, but man. So you got Pearl Jam and Limp Bizkit within the same.
Those are very different things. Whoa.
Not musically, but name wise. We're just.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Everyone
yeah,
in
yeah.
the 90s was like, okay, they got the Rolling Stones, they got the Beatles, they got Led Zeppelin. We got to go our own way, guys. Hey, how about we keep it strictly to the semen? I love it. Let's go.
You ever play Ookie Cookie? No. You want to name your band after it? Sure. Yeah, Limp Bizkit is about several gentlemen maybe at a party or some sort of gathering of usually just men. Who
Which
might,
is the worst part.
Oh,
it
yes,
makes it
absolutely.
Better if women
Only
are
terrible
there,
things.
You know? If like women were there
well,
watching,
yeah, absolutely,
it's like, hey,
because
man.
They can moderate.
Yes, and like try to show off. It's like, see how, like the loser is really the winner when women are watching. Because like the loser is like, yeah, they all finished before me, but look how long I'm lasting.
Look how claw my white is.
I'm going to eat this biscuit and then I'll see you in the room for some business.
I don't know, honey. They just want to go into this bedroom, and they say that I need to bring a graham cracker. They didn't elaborate. And then we started a band. Is that what Nookie is about, too?
Yes.
Is the cookie in Nookie the titular Limp Bizkit?
Cookie? I feel like I'm talking to a stoner Riddler right now. Is the cookie in Nookie, Batman? Then find me.
The stoner Riddler, just like a bunch of like bongs made out of water bottles, and
his cane is
jugs
an upside down
guitars.
Bong. Like he's just swirling around the upside
yeah,
down
absolutely.
Bong, and then like every riddles,
he just tells the same riddles.
He's like, all right, so if I leave, oh man, what was I talking about? Wait, where do we start?
So there's a man and his boy, and the doctor was a woman. Fuck. So, what have you been doing, comedy wise, man? What have you been getting to shows or open mics or stuff like that?
Not really. Only like the local. I've been doing a show, John Pronich. Should we be saying people's names? They're not going to listen to this.
No.
Is it no, you shouldn't use names, or no, they're not going to listen to this?
I mean, take your pick.
It's fine. I don't want to be on those shows anyway. You can edit around this, so cut. And then, so John, yeah. great comedian, run some great shows around here. And
that's the part I'll cut out.
Yep, exactly. So I've been doing shows, a couple of shows. The first show I did at the Cape Cod, locally in our Shell Beach area, which is an eatery. And that was fine. The first time doing stand-up after like the whole COVID quarantine, not doing it for multiple months, it was a lot better than I was expecting performance-wise. But I... Mm-hmm. had a borderline anxiety attack just because there were so many people around. I was like, I'm going to get it. Like, this is...
Oh, yeah.
This is it. And then also, right before I went on stage, the host, like, pointed out, I was like, man, love doing a comedy show during COVID with a bunch of people without masks just laughing right towards me. And then I was like, all right, you're next, comedian. I was like, wait, hold on. He's right. Like,
he makes a good
point.
Like,
this is basically a fire hose of COVID right now. It's just like, you know what? Everyone just don't laugh. And that's never a problem with my sets. People laughing, so.
That's not something you have to worry about.
So
anyway.
I never have to worry about it.
I did a show that was a drive-in show.
Yes.
So I performed at a show where people drove their cars in and sat in their cars and responded to jokes with like honking or flashing their lights.
Right.
And that was very weird because you have to perform like it's so hard to do comedy without laughter. And I know that every podcast talks about comedy. Every single podcast devolves into comedians talking about the ins and outs of comedy.
Comedy and Marvel movies. Don't forget.
Oh, yeah. Can't forget about
that.
The
two rules.
Iron Man, pretty good guy.
But what if he wasn't a billionaire?
Then he would have nothing. He would just be man who was kidnapped.
Oh my god, can we think about this? Real quick, can we just think about this? Iron Man isn't rich. So in the first Iron Man movie, he gets captured by terrorists, taken into the cave.
Yeah, he's there. There's got to be a different reason that he's there if he's not rich. So he's like a journalist.
Yes, he's a journalist. Yeah.
Or no, his name is just associated. He's like the Don Jr. of Stark Industries. Like, he doesn't actually bring anything to the table. He just has the name recognition that is needed to like go commit to foreign
laws. Yes, exactly. So he gets kidnapped, put in the cave. Okay. They're like, make us a weapon. And now with your great backstory, he's like, I just bring the weapons. I don't build them. It's like, build a weapon. And then he doesn't build it. And so they kill him. And the movie's like 20 minutes. Yeah. And there's not, you know, 20 movies after that. So good job, Stan Lee.
I like how that's so many superheroes. Batman and Iron Man. Like, both of their superpowers is just being super rich.
Yes.
And yeah, you can argue that Batman has all the martial arts training and everything, but
because
would
he
have gotten those opportunities if he was not super rich? Yes, come on.
The normal people, when we want to become a superhero, and it's like, all right, I need to learn karate, I'm taking the YMCA karate class down the street for $5 a session. Batman gets to fly to freaking China to learn from the guy that created the martial arts style. So again,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, my favorite superhero is YMC Angel. He really like flies into business, and he's a public utility for the common man. But he might give you HPV. Shouts out to YMCAs across the country. They're a great place.
My one weakness, I might give
people.
You HPV. Wait, that's not your weakness. No, it just makes me feel bad. You know, I'm fucked.
It's just like a thing.
It's just a thing, you know. It hangs heavy on my conscience. After.
So the premise, I guess, of the show is that we're
not done by your story, though.
Are gonna... What was my story?
Yeah,
I forgot.
I distracted you too much. Doing comedy for honking cars.
Oh,
driving
yeah, they
comedy.
Honked. They flashed their
Is
lights.
It scary when
it's
they honk?
It's very hard to perform.
Because it's so startling. You don't know when it's
going to
come.
No, I didn't have to go on first. That was the lucky bit, is I didn't have to go on first. So you kind of like got a feel for it, And that the best part, the worst part about going on first is no comedy show will reliably do a sound check. And at that sound check, whatever went right will invariably go wrong for the first comedian.
Always.
So the first comedian who went out, it was on a baseball field. Shouts out to Ruben Escobedo and BMO for doing their Pick Your Poison show. It's a fantastic show up in San Jose. And so it was on this baseball diamond, and the mic would go out if you like went too far in certain directions, or if you got your body in between the mic and the transmitter. So I got to watch all the comics before me make all the mistakes, and then go out there and like not have to make those mistakes. But it was still really weird getting your timing right without like hearing laughter and like having to substitute flashing lights and honks for it. It's very strange.
And it's definitely a show not to do new material. Like, you have to do the stuff that you know, where like you know your beats, you know where like usually laughter's here, light laughter, you know, punchline, that. But it's hard.
See, that's the fun part about Ruben's show that I did, is it's called Pick Your Poison, and what they do is they put up on the Jumbotron random topics that you just have to riff on, and you have like 6 minutes to do these you know, however many topics, and you just have to make up jokes on the spot. So you have no beats, you have no rhythm, you have no like thing that you can reliably, you know, go like, okay, I know that I need to wait here for this, because I have jokes where it's all about, you know, there's a big space in between the end of the joke and then like the punchline. And the length of that space is completely judged on the audience. Like, if I see that like the joke is taking time, it's time to like percolate through them or whatever, like, you know, if they're all kind of like waiting for it or whatever, I need to speed up or, you know, whatever it may be. But I know that there's a pause there with like just telling entirely new jokes that you've never done at all. You have no frame of reference.
Yeah.
And it's exhilarating.
Like,
it was a lot of
fun. I'm sure. Definitely something new, something cool, and probably limits hecklers.
Oh, yeah, that's the best part, is it's hard to heckle with a honker.
Except every time, like, you start talking, like, so the other day, I was, you know, I went down there.
That would be pretty funny.
That would just start slamming on the hood. It's like, you, shut up!
Oh, cars.
Silly cars. You know, driving shit.
I guess the premise of the show, what I had in mind, is that every episode we would have somebody on who, you know, is a comic friend or, you know, just somebody...
A music lover.
One of our entertaining buddies. A music lover. An individual of renown or not. It doesn't matter. We're just going to have a fun time. We're just going to have a good old grand time coasting on Nick and I's own fame. And our guests be damned. But for the first episode, I thought, or I don't know if this episode will come out first, honestly. But for the first episode that we're recording, maybe it comes out, you know, later down in the... memory banks, you know, because we've got a bunch of guests that are fun or whatever. I figured it would be cool to each of us present an album from our past, because the whole premise is, you know, everybody has that album that really means a lot to them, or, you know, has a lot of memories associated with it. And so I figured, you know, we should each have an opportunity to present one of ours.
And yes, an important album to our lives, to our existence, our who we have become as people sometimes, possibly.
Yeah, possibly. Or just, you know, it reminds you of that time in seventh grade when you saw a cool lizard.
What is that for you?
I don't know. I just thought of a lizard. So I guess we'll start. Let's begin the show.
Yes.
This I would like to present my album, Nick. I told you that I was going. I tried to, you know, say we'd keep it secret for the most part from each other. I still don't know your album. Mm-hmm. Due to engineering capabilities, there's no way that I could prevent Nick from seeing this. So he's seen my album by now. But my album, It's a band that, it's a good band, you know, it's not my favorite band by any means. It's not like a band that I even really listen to religiously or had a lot of memories, you know, was a fan of for a long, long time. But this album came out when I was like 9 or 10, and
how old are
my
you?
My friend had it.
I'm so sorry. I just
I'm 31.
You're 30. No, okay. See, I'm 31 as well, Rick. Okay, I don't want to be this person.
Yeah.
But I'm looking at the year here. What was that 1996? We were like 6 or 7.
1998.
Okay, we're 8 or 9.
I was born in 89.
Same here.
So 89, 98 minus 89 is 9. So so I was 9 or 10. Okay. What is this? I didn't come here to do math, Nick. What is this? Or am I being attacked over sums?
Well, I just when you said the age, I was like, wait, I could have sworn we were so much closer in age, but you were just like making it sound like, you know, you're getting ready to, you know, move on to college, you know. Baby in
this
the back
came out
seat.
When I was 46 years old.
And start moving out. I'm sorry. I love you. Actually, oh my god, that is a verbatim of whenever I do something stupid with anyone I love, which is, I'm sorry, I love you.
I'm sorry, I love you. You have to forgive me now. I said a nice thing. So this album came out when I was 8, 9, or 10. Is that good enough
That's
for
fine.
You?
I'm sorry.
Will that work in your little math?
I like to.
World?
I'm trying to picture young Rick, so I just
Tesla.
Need to know. 8, 9, or 10.
Oh, I'll show you a picture later.
I'm sure.
But my friend Scott, got this album. He's been a very good friend of mine for a long, long time. Got this album, and I was at his house for like every day for so long. We were just like the best of friends and hung out every single day, and we would listen to this album all the time. And it's a fun album. And so my album is The Offspring's Americana. Came out in 1998. Nick, have you ever listened to The Offspring?
I have never listened to The Offspring that I know of. You know, I'm sure there are one of those bands where it's like, oh, you've never listened to The Offspring, but you've heard that one song. You're like, oh, this is The Offspring, you know, like that kind of thing. But no, never listened to The Offspring. I don't know. I have this weird thing. I don't know. This might be just like some weird stereotype thing, but just Offspring seems like just screams like Vans Warped Tour to me.
Oh,
I don't
yeah,
know.
Absolutely.
Just like, there's just like a lot of like Dickies shorts with high socks listening to Offspring.
Well, then I shouldn't tell you that my next album is Blink-182's Take Off Your Pants and Jacket.
But they're okay. They're fine. No, I've just never listened to Offspring. And actually, this morning I told my girlfriend, you know, we're doing the podcast and that you were going to do an Offspring album. And she actually told me that her mom is a big Offspring fan and actually was like the band my girlfriend would want to play in car rides whenever she wanted to take a nap. It's like, oh, put the Offspring on. It's like Lullaby.
Wow. As someone who did listen to The Offspring, that does not scream nap music.
Well,
to
that's
me.
What. So after she said that, I was like, "Oh, I need to listen to Offspring." Like I was like picturing something different in my head. But like, if you're taking naps, but I wanted to wait with you. I want to break my I want to break my Offspring cherry.
Bust
with you.
Your Offspring cherry.
Yep, and make an Offspring with you.
Oh, baby. Yeah, this album, I don't know. I think it's probably my favorite album by them. Like I said, I wasn't a huge Offspring fan by any means, like, especially before this album. And I've gone back and I've listened to all their discography and, you know, there's songs that I like, throughout it, you know, they've got great songs. But this album, just because of the time and place, how, you know, I just have so many clear memories of being at Scott's place, just like hanging out. I remember, we were listening to this album when we got the idea to, we used to make little videos on his webcam, you know, like before there was YouTube or anything. And there was any way to like put it out there, really, we would just make little videos for ourselves. And we made a video where we advertised Banana Boat sunscreen. And if we ever get a sponsor, I hope it's Banana Boat sunscreen, because that will complete the cycle. The Ouroboros will eat its own tail, and I will have made it. Like,
why sunscreen? Do you remember why?
it was what he had in his room. It was just, we saw it there, and we were like, let's make a commercial for it. And so we just did a bunch of foolish, dumb stuff where, like, we'd squirt it on each other. And, like, it's Banana Boat. Like, it was just the dumbest stuff.
A bunch of 8, 9, 10-year-olds playing with sunscreen in front of a webcam.
Yeah, a bunch of 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12-year-olds just
what can possibly
squirting
happen?
Banana Boat all over each other.
I think everyone that's listening, and myself included, can just assume what the first move was with the sunscreen, which is a nice Pearl Jam all over your face.
Well, to be honest, I don't know if you've ever utilized the Banana Boat sunscreen brand, but it smells so goddamn
good. It does smell good.
It smells like coconut beach deliciousness.
Not like
that
banana,
is the epitome
is
of
weird.
The beach. Right? It should be Coconut Boat.
Just saying.
Coco Canoe. I've renamed Banana Boat.
I'm going cuckoos for Cocos.
Oh, dude, we could even, we'll cross-brand with other cereals, because...
You get a bottle of the coconut suntan lotion in your Coco Puffs. Like a little travel size. You open it up.
Oh, that's your prize inside?
That's the prize. It's like, oh, right, I got it. Oh, no, it broke in the cereal. All right, eat it anyway. It's coconut flavored.
General Mills is really stooping, just giving travel size hygiene accessories out and all their. Oh, look, Mom! At the bottom of this bowl of tricks is a toothbrush.
Oh, I love this idea! Oh my god!
Terrible prizes.
Hot Cheetos. All right, dental floss. Oh man.
I guess. All right, so Americana is the album. It's 14 songs. I didn't look up any of the Wikipedia information. I thought that, it might be cool to do a little bio about it or anything, but all you really need to know is that it came out in 1998, and it's The Offspring.
Yes, their fifth album in their legacy is all I got to add to that.
Oh, I see somebody's Wikipedia'd them.
No, not Wikipedia, just Spotify, because I like to know. This is something that I love with music. This is very important to me. Whenever it's like, you got to listen to this album, I got to know where the band is. You know, is this a first album? Is this a 12th album? What's going on in your career? So, like, fifth album, I guess we could say, you've gotten your flow, you got your sound. You know what's going on in the recording studio. You know, it's not like your first rodeo. It's like, okay, we know what is needed to make a good album. Now let's go and make this. So it's good to know. Fifth album.
But also by fifth, like, you're done with... Because every band comes into... When they become a band, they start recording their first album. That's their, like, basis of songs that they've been playing for, the past 10 years or whatever.
Yes.
They're playing those songs on the album. And then, by the second and third album, they're running out of those songs. Mm-hmm. And so they're having to write new. By the fifth album, I think, is, like, the time when the band is, like, kind of reestablishing their sound almost.
Yes.
Because they have nothing that they can, like, fall back on anymore by the fifth album, maybe one song or something, but they change sound. I think that this album really does change their sound a lot. So let's dive into it. So this first opening track off of the album is just is honestly like the coolest opening track I think for an album. Like, it's 9 seconds and it's just called Welcome. And it opens the album so well. This is Welcome by The Offspring.
Welcome to Americana. Please make your selection followed by the pound sign now.
That's it. That's the whole...
Oh my god.
That's the whole intro.
So much to say about 9 seconds. Okay, first of all, this is something that I miss. I don't know. Maybe I don't listen to the right people anymore, but like intros, skits are not a thing on albums anymore. And in the 90s and early 2000s, it was like, you got a CD. It's like, there's 32 songs on here, where actually there's 12 skits. And the rest are actual
and
songs.
And interludes.
Yeah, and interludes and everything. Also, that voice. I haven't heard that voice in so long. That's OG Siri. Let's be honest.
Yeah. That's sir.
It is sir. Yes. Hi, welcome to... I always love those because it's like they use 12 different guys in the same range, but like they all couldn't... like.
Yeah.
But like they said the sentence, but like the director or the editor was like, you know, I'm going to go out on a limb here. I'm going to say I like a different word from each guy. I'm going to pin it all together. Trust me, you're not going to notice that there's a difference.
Yeah, they never pick whatever word it is. It's never at, like, said at the same point that it was originally said.
Yes.
When they record it. Like it starts with the word welcome, but when he recorded it, it was probably like, you are welcome. And so it's like, it sounds like the end of a sentence. And so it's like, welcome, too. Like, that's how I look at it. But I think that's a fun intro. I think it's great. I also miss skits and stuff like
yes,
that.
Yes, and I always loved it too because back in my day, when you listen to the CD, a good intro is when you knew that the album was over because there was the album would loop around and everything. And sometimes if you're really into the album or like it was like very compacted, sometimes it's like, wait, is the album started over yet? I don't know. But you got freaking welcome. There's no question.
Yeah.
I love it.
And it just brings you right in. And then it's cool because it because it's so short, it's just like welcome, boom. And then the next song just really starts off with a bang. I won't say what my favorite song is on the album until the end. But I like this song. And it just I'll play welcome to go into it.
Perfect.
Because you kind of have to have the full experience. But this song is called Have You Ever.
Okay.
Oh, here we go.
Please,
so we've got it playing welcome.
Followed by the sign.
And here we
now.
Go.
Yeah.
And it just like
boom,
hits in, and it's got this cool intro, and then you don't really even know how the song is gonna go until it really kicks in right here.
Oh.
Boom.
Okay.
It's just got that classic, like, punk, like, fast pop, drums.
Wow. That's not what I was expecting after that build-up. Oh, this is okay.
Right?
I understand a lot of...
It's a good track.
Yes, this is a great track. I understand a lot of early 90s kids right now. Like, honestly. Like, that song, I understand why... They're a thing. Like, that's cool. That's fun. That's classic punk. That is, that's great.
Right? But it's without, like, the early... Their early stuff is, like, more, I would say, like, it's, like, rougher.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of, like, there's more, like, almost yelling aspects to it. And this is much more, like, clean and, like, you know, singing. And it goes back to that, like, that intro kind of, like...
Those drums are crazy. How would you even come up with, like, that, like, weird kind of, like, offbeat thing to it?
It's, like...
That's crazy.
That's honestly, when I listen to this band, what sticks out the most to me is the drummer is... Because I've played drums, and so I know, like, how hard it is to keep that time, how
mm-hmm.
quick that is, just... Like, it's so hard.
Yeah, that is crazy. And it makes sense why now, as I'm hearing it, I'm, like, having all these memories of, like, my friends who drum being, like, love the Offspring. Oh, freaking Offspring. Yeah.
It's just, like, classic punk drumming.
Yes.
Like, at its, you know.
Man,
you know,
and
I don't know,
solid voice.
Is the height of punk.
Well, okay, let's if you don't mind, let's, can we, like, do a little, like kind of, like, a sum up? Of what's going on in music during this time in 98?
Yeah. Let's do it.
So, like, 98, what are we... Were we 2 years out of Kurt Cobain killing himself?
Mm-hmm.
98, we're really getting...
98 was when there was a lot of electronic stuff being added to music.
Yes. And, of course, like, we're getting a lot of our big boy band, girl band.
Yeah.
Britney Spears, which we will get into more because... I will not hate on any of that because that is my 7, 8, 9, 10, 11-year-old life.
Hey, I'm a Billy fan. What can I say?
Okay, so this is definitely a little bit, I don't know, in its own plane, I would say. You know, I can't think of anything... in, like, another band that's kind of doing the same thing. I guess, like, your Green Day and your Blink-182, but even this is more, Like, I would even say, and no offense to any Green Day Blink-182 fans, because I'm in that boat with you, I love them, but this seems a little bit more authentic punk than the other
yeah.
two.
Yeah, especially at this time, this was a much more like a callback to classic punk with the aesthetics and smoothness and cleanliness of like the developing technology.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And also, I just love thinking too, where it's like imagine you're in high school. This album just came out. Everyone's listening to, you know, the Backstreet Boys, the country music. Because also we forget country music. You got your like Garth Brooks, right, Shania Twain, all that kind of stuff going on. People are listening to that. But you're
man feeling like a woman.
Yes, but you're Offspring guy. You're walking around with that flannel, that long hair.
Oh yeah.
And you're like no.
You have Dexter Holland, the singer from Offspring is Dexter Holland, and you've got his like he always had like the spiky blonde hair.
Oh,
like that was the time when it was just like spike up your blonde hair, like Sum 41.
Yes,
that was around that.
Okay,
no, I think Sum 41 was later. Sum 41 was later.
Okay,
granted,
probably a big Offspring influencer or influenced by the Offspring.
Absolutely.
But no, I thinking like if I'm in high school and stuff, like I'm repping this. I'm walking around. I'm like openly like, you know, cassette tape, or if you got that money, the CDs, CD player. I'm like walking around, be like, what do you listen to? Freaking Offspring, like. Screw you.
Yeah,
you know, you're just like repping that Offspring, wearing the t-shirt every day. I get it. This is
torn
fun.
Jeans, like, yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely. And the other cool thing about this album is it's like, it's so classically punk. Like, there are two songs. Okay, so there's one song that's like a long song that's like, kind of like how the end of albums a lot of times would have like kind of an opus that had like a lot of pieces to it or whatever.
Yes.
But of the actual songs on the album, there are two that are over 3.5 minutes.
Wow.
Like, that's it. Everything else is just, like, boom, short, like, to the point, like, hit it. Like,
oh, that's
this
awesome.
This Have You Ever song is one of the longer songs on the album.
And was this a single
album? No, we'll get to the singles.
Okay.
Don't you worry. Don't get ahead of yourself.
Okay.
We'll get to the singles, and you'll be like, oh, yeah. So the next song is another song that I really, really enjoy. I can't help myself. I love most of the songs on this album. But I'm going to do the same thing that I did. And because this album very much like leads into each song, like the end of every song kind of goes boom into the next one. You kind of have to. So we'll start at the end of Have You Ever, and it'll go into this next song, which is Staring at the Sun. That's always so cool to end a song, which is like...
Oh, look at you. Yep. Yep, yes. That's what I needed right there.
Totally different drums, but like...
Oh, I love that. I was feeling something needed to come in, and I was hoping for it, and I'm so glad. Jeez.
So good. So good. 2 minutes and 13 seconds. I mean, this song is so fantastic. Like, I love it.
Oh.
Oh, damn. Oh, it's so good.
Okay, this is cool.
Yeah.
I'm really getting it. I understand.
Yeah, it's so good.
Because there's bands where I've, like, you know, big bands that are very popular and very important to music that I don't listen to, that I've tried to get into. Radiohead is one. In the last couple of years, I finally understood it. But, like, everyone's like, Radiohead. And then you listen to it, it's like, I'm not getting it. I don't understand what the, you know, and then sometimes age, sometimes it's whatever. This Offspring, I get it right away. Like, it makes sense why they're very popular.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, it's good rock and roll music.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like straight up, just classic. It's got classic elements and it's got like modern elements, but it's just like people play, like, this is how this band should be playing music, honestly. Like, I feel like they've got, they grew a lot from their past, which I prefer this to a lot of their older stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the future, they kind of changed ways a lot that I am not as much of a fan of. But this was, like, I feel like the peak of them playing as a band.
Well, I feel like this is also a great, I don't really have a term for it, but, like, a good, like, kind of like a meet in the middle with like a child and their parent, where it's like,
yeah,
you know, don't get the parents' music, whatever, but like this is a great thing of like, you know, your parent loves the Ramones and like the Sex Pistols and everything, but you're never really into it. But it's like, oh, you know, mom, dad, listen to Offspring, and like that's the one where the parents are like, you know what? This is some solid punk music. You know,
yeah,
the thumbs up type of thing, and then it's like, you know, you have that connection then, you know, we've listened to Offspring or something. A great Thanksgiving band.
Oh yeah,
bring
yeah.
Coming together this Thanksgiving with the Offspring.
Have Thanksgiving with your Offspring.
Yes.
Not this
and
year.
And have an
it's
Offspring
COVID times.
With your Offspring.
Yeah. This next song is not my favorite song on the album by any means, but it's a song that everybody has heard, and Nick, when I play it, you're going to be like, oh, I've heard this song.
Is this the song?
This is one of the singles from the album. I'm absolutely sure of it. I don't have to look it up to know that, like, it had to have been.
Okay.
This song is called Pretty Fly for a White Guy.
Wait. Okay, all right, okay, Offspring, we have a problem now. Offspring, we have a problem. And all the girlies say I'm pretty
fly for a white guy. Okay, so that horrendous intro aside, and the whole, the late 90s was peak, like, white people can't dance. Like, that was like,
yes,
they've
yes.
been made for eternity, but like, the late 90s was like, finally, white people were starting to get the shit end of the... Like, not really the shit end of the stick, but, like, we were starting to be the butt of some jokes.
Yes, yes. The punchline, like, because you're white or something, you know, the being white is a punchline now.
Yeah, and so this was definitely of the time.
did not know that this is them. I mean, it's early to say. I know we're, what, tracks, song 4 or 14
in? 4.
This is kind of like... I don't know. I don't know the history of the song. I don't know anything about it. But, like, I'm getting, from the first couple tracks, I'm getting a hint of the record company, the record label, heard the album. We're like, we need a radio song. We need a single.
Yeah.
Big time. And they're like, okay, we'll do something. And it's like, well, we kind of have something already here. You know, there's something going on. I don't like what's going on.
Yeah.
I don't like the vibes on this. I love the song because that guitar that comes in is great. I'm not even lying. It is great, but I'm not, it's not cohesive to what is being heard right now.
No, it's definitely an outlier for the track. That being said, the main riff is fucking dope. It's a good
100%.
Guitar riff. Like, this riff right here. That's like a sweet, like, that's like
that
a
is
straight up,
beautiful.
You know, old school guitar riff.
Yes.
And then it kind of, like, loses me when it goes. Well, this part I like. But then it's kind of like, this is what I feel like they eventually got into later. I don't know. I can't say that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But, like, it's, like you said, it's definitely an outlier for the album.
Yeah. It might be one of those songs,
but I think
too,
it was
like,
ruined by...
Go ahead.
I think it was ruined by, like, it being, like, the music video got played a lot, and I saw it all the time, and it just, like... It's kind of a dumb song.
Yeah.
Like,
oh,
honestly,
oh,
is.
Definitely. And it has that vibe also of, like, you hear, like, a lot of times where it's like, oh, we're just trying to finish up the album. You know, you need another song or something. And it's like, let's just try to, like, do something. And, like, the most simplest thing becomes, like, your biggest thing, you know. Portugal the Man, that song, Feel It Still.
Oh, Feel
like,
It
that
Still.
Big song. Like, I'm a big Portugal the Man fan. And I read a story that's like, it was just like, it was just testing if the bass was in tune that day or something, you know? He's just doing the bass line. It's like, oh, well, what's that? And then, you know, he becomes this and that and stuff. And like one of the band members was like, we probably spent a quarter of the time on that song that we've like making it than we have our entire discography. And yet that is our biggest song, which is the, you know, easiest one we've ever written.
It's so crazy how it's honestly just once that melody is so like catchy, you just find that melody, and it doesn't matter if it's difficult, you know? Your brain mm-hmm. doesn't care if something's particularly hard, like, unless you're educated about that thing.
Yeah.
But when it's just, like, a catchy melody, like, it just, it hits. And this mm-hmm. is Pretty Fly for a White Guy, it's a catchy melody. And it was, a funny joke at the time, and so, like, it was very popular.
And that's another thing, too, that, like, kind of, like, takes away from it. It's like, funny. Like, no, we're punk. This isn't...
Right. Yeah, yeah.
No. We don't laugh at song titles.
Yeah, it's very much a joke song. That being said, and Offspring does have... Like, some of their songs are kind of funny. Like, there's a song later in the album that is pretty funny, but it's also like a really good song.
Yeah, yeah. And that's fine. I love a good sense of humor, and that's why... Tenacious D... Tenacious D is, like, a different level, though. That is, like, a great...
Oh, yeah, yeah,
mesh of true music, but with comedy. Yeah,
but that they like set out to do that. They were like, oh, we're gonna be a funny, epic band.
Yes, and the joke of we are the greatest band of all time. Like, exactly. That, it's genius.
Yeah.
Very, very smart. Have you seen Jack Black's video that's been going viral of him doing the dance to WAP?
Oh, to WAP, on his halfpipe.
The best part isn't him doing the dance. The best part is when he gets sprayed directly in the face by, yeah, I assume his child, where it's like the director was just spraying me with the hose, and he's like, yeah, I'm gonna go for the face.
Nah.
Just like straight, and he like, but he's an actor. He's a professional. Right. He pushes through. He keeps going.
Truly utilizing his... all of his talents in the world to be sprayed in the face. So this is one thing that I can say really good about... that was not a sentence. This is one good thing I can say about Pretty Fly for a White Guy is it... Because it's such a joke, like, happy, fun song, it leads into this next song, which I think also might have been... I'm gonna go ahead and Wikipedia.
Wikipedia, because I also had a thought before we leave this song... as I said, being a wedding DJ, one of my favorite things was, like, I would talk to couples and, like, try to figure out, like, their age range, 8, 9, 10, 11. I would always, like, try to figure out, like, what's, like, when were they in high school? Like, what's your guilty pleasure music? And, like, try to, like, play mm-hmm. kind of, like, the, like, kind of cliche, but, like, you're like, oh, I've never heard this song in a long time. I missed it by never playing Fly for a White Guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that would kill. That there are, like, there are, one wedding specifically was a couple who met at Arizona State, and, like,
oh my
and,
God.
Like, all their classmates from Arizona State came to the cliffs in Shell Beach, and, like, someone requested, what is that song? Third Eye Blind.
A Semi-Charmed Life.
That song? Yes.
Semi-Charmed Life?
Yes. That's Third Eye Blind. Yes.
I think so, yeah, yeah.
Someone came up and requested it, and, like, it's, like, one of those songs where it's, like, this is, like, one of your favorite songs. Not, like, something that's gonna get everyone going, but he's, like, trust me, dude, this is always, like, a thing from a requestee. Dude, trust me. Like, it's gonna go off. Every time, so I'm like, okay, whatever, put it on, and I mean, like, it was just shooting off, and everyone knew the words, and the bride came over to me, and was like, come out and dance with us! I was like, I don't know this song, and then, like, I'm, like, jumping around with the bride and the groom, and they're saying all the words, so they keep going, come on! And I just keep waiting for, like, just wait. Do-do-do, I was like, is that only the part you know, is the do-dos? I was like, yes, yeah, pretty much. I don't know, but... Offspring should have been played at that wedding, is what
Pretty
I'm saying.
Pretty Fly for a White Guy is the perfect wedding song. Like towards the beginning of the night when everybody's still, like, when they're, like, happy drunk and they're, like, the wedding just happened and it's like, let's dance now! And, like, you get a couple songs in and then you get Pretty Fly and everyone's like, oh, shit! And they point at the dorkiest white guy in the crowd. They're like, this is Darren's song! This is Darren's song! Darren, get out of here! You're Pretty Fly for a White Guy! Ha ha! Darren, look at his socks!
I know all the words!
Of course he does. But it does lead into this next song, which I was right, is another single off of the album, and another very good song. It's a very sad song. It's very, like, it's so crazy that it comes out of such a funny, funny song. But this is called The Kids Aren't All Right.
Ooh, I love this.
You can already tell it's like angsty, like mm-hmm. just those chords. I just imagine like them playing this live and just like that long guitar chord.
Oh, this is a solid concert opener. This is like yeah. you're going to see the Offspring. Lights go down on the stage. They come out. Woo 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 woo. Dun, 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 you know that. Just this is. Boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, and it's got that classic like Offspring thing where it's got like cool riffs and then it drops out. For yeah, see everything it drops out for the.
Yes. Yep.
And this song is just about like. It's about. This neighborhood, him living in this neighborhood, or I don't know if it's like him as a character or whatever, but mm-hmm. about being in this neighborhood where like everybody just like has this terrible life, and like it's just like, this really torn down place, like just talking about people who have had it really rough and like turned to like drugs and addiction and stuff. It's like it's very good.
I like this too because it's not too like preachy. You know how like some kind of like punk bands can be like okay, it's like the kids aren't all right. You know, it's like we're fine.
Do this.
Honestly,
you need to go in there and fucking change the system.
Exactly. It's like you're from Paso Robles. Yeah. You've had no challenges in your life. You don't know, but it's not like too preachy. And also, I like. I don't know if they're trying to do this, if this is a reference from the Who song, which is The Kids Are All Right.
Yeah, I would imagine.
But I love that, and I love a good reference.
Since we're like, you know, 5 songs into the album, let's take a break real quick, and we will be back in a minute.
Cool. You ever pee so long you start getting bored?
Yeah, actually, yeah. That's it's like
we're just like okay, I'm done, like let's go.
It's like when you forget to bring your phone into the toilet with you and you're just like fuck, what am I even gonna do? Dude, like I have to read the back of this toothpaste container for a while. Let's see,
wait, is your toilet close enough where you can get the toothpaste?
No, what? No, it's just like, you know, just around. We don't need to talk about it. Welcome back to Spin Doctors.
What did people before phones do while they took a? Anyway.
That's why. Well, no, that's why you had like
just thought the, about
the,
your day.
The bathroom magazines. Everybody had baskets of magazines.
Yeah. Yep. Great Christmas gift. Good bathroom book.
Yeah. Everybody loves a good bathroom magazine. Nothing better to collect your. We don't need to talk about that anymore. welcome back to the show. Let's move right along to the next track on the album. I really, really like this song. And it's really cool, because it's called Feelings. The song is called Feelings. But with a song called Feelings, it's not about anything that you might think it's about. Let's go ahead and play it.
Okay.
So yeah, it's just immediately like feelings of hate. Like it's just like angry. Imagine beating on your face. It's literally just like about hating somebody.
This is. It's just it's just straight forward. This is so great. It's not like trying to be like, oh, I'm trying to like make a you know allusion to this, or like, oh, I'm alone on a street. Oh, my feelings.
Yeah,
you know,
like,
it's like
oh, feelings. I have so many feelings about everything. But no, it's just about hate and just like feeling mad. And this song, I might just like, if we can talk over the whole song, I might just like play. Well, okay, I'll skip over this verse and back into this chorus. Because at the end of this second chorus is so, like, I love this. It goes into, like, the breakdown. Oh, my God, it's so good.
Yes.
Oh, my God, it's so good. Okay, one more time.
Yes. Yeah, go back to that.
First of all, he says, feelings, you're not very nice. Like, he hates them. You're not very nice. I hate you. I want to beat your fucking face. Because you're not very nice. You're not very nice. Ah!
Yep.
So good. Into the solo. Like, so good. It's such a good song. Less than 3 minutes.
I love
minutes.
It, too, because I always love... I love thinking of songs, like, when they're performed live.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, you've, like, that build-up and everything, and then, like, that pause, like, everything goes black.
Exactly.
And it's like, go. And then just lights are going, just... just go, go. So, also, so many moshes at these Offspring concerts. Like, there are, like... Like, there are parents where it's like, oh, yeah, you see this cut on the side of my eye? Yeah, Offspring, 99.
Like the Americana
tour, dude.
Right
I got elbowed right in the
my
pit.
Eye.
Oh, you got elbowed? Nah, poop. Right in there, it's infected for years. I got to take eye drops every other day.
Yeah, dude, this song
also, I don't know if you can hear, but the two puppies in my room are fighting now, and it's their form of moshing because of the Offspring.
Yeah, they're just getting down. They appreciate it.
A lot of choking. Hey.
My cat's been running around here meowing the entire time, so I've been trying to kick her away from time. Not actually kick her, that sounds way worse than it is. But I've been trying to...
Would her cover of the song be Meowings?
And we're going to move right along. this next...
Nobody likes
what I like
puns.
About Feelings is, like, first of all, like, with a name like Feelings, you're like, oh, I don't know what the song's going to be about. And then it's just about wanting to fucking kick the shit out of somebody. And it's less than 3 minutes long. Just, like, straight up, straightforward, punk, bam, bam, bam. So good.
Also, kind of like how long my feelings last, usually, about anything. It's just a little under 3 minutes, and then I'm over it.
This is how we know that Nick is not recording with his girlfriend in the room. all right, this next song is a very risque song. And when I was listening to this song at, you know, 8, 9, 10 years old, I felt very adult and like sexy listening to this song.
Oh, like, it's, okay. So we've gotten to that point, which
yeah,
is like
this
that.
Was like
one
this
of those
was the song
songs. Is this okay?
This was the song that I felt like I didn't want to listen to in front of my mom or anything. Like everything else,
oh,
you know,
yes.
You can listen to it in front of your mom, and she's just gonna be like, "Oh, that's trash music. I don't like that. Blah 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 blah. It's just loud or whatever." But this this one was where I was like, "Oh, I can't listen to this in front of mom." This one's called "She's Got Issues."
All right, hold up. Okay, hold on. Okay, so let's go over this. Song's called "She's Got Issues." You're like, never heard this. Okay, let's start it up. And just that, bam, bam, it's like, okay, this isn't a love song. This isn't about
There's
her issues of being like a good lover and a nice person. This is.
She's got issues, but I still love my baby. No, this is a song about. It definitely doesn't go with like the majority vibe of like punky you know ness that the rest of the album has.
Right.
It definitely is a break. But I feel like at track 7 you kind of need like a break song where you're just kind of like, all right, I can kind of chill this album.
Definitely, yeah. Okay, yeah. It's calmed down a little bit compared to the other ones and the way it started.
So let's get to the first, like, sexy part. Okay, here we go. So this is where it gets, like, sexy. No, maybe that's not it yet. We'll get there. There's the chorus. So it's, you know, obviously about, like, oh... I mean, which is kind of, like, played out now. Like, oh, I'm you know, sleeping with a... girl with issues. Like, I don't precisely enjoy the message, but it's you know, it's a pretty good song.
I mean, it's great because I mean, there's a kink into falling for someone
right.
that you know has issues.
Yeah.
Like, this is a song that gets played in the movie about the girl that's gonna ruin the main.
Yeah, absolutely.
Run, you know.
Your dogs are really going to town.
This damn Offspring music. You see what it does to the kids? No wonder the adults didn't love it.
Oh, here we go. Like, you told me 100 times how your father left and he's gone. Yeah, so like, Yeah, that's okay.
And also, this is again, listeners, with all your like freaking millennial Gen Z fucking meme culture shit. It's like, call me daddy. No. This is original. That is freaking. That is comedy gold. In 1998, she's always talking about her daddy, but she's always talking about her father, but she calls me daddy. Exactly. I mean, come on.
This was like, also, that's how you can tell this was so like late 90s, was all that stuff that like now is very, very hack. And you're like, oh yeah, you know, everybody's made this joke 1,000 times. In the late 90s, everybody hadn't made that joke 1,000 times, at least not in widespread media. So that, you know, punk band also is making these jokes, it's like, oh wow, okay.
Yes, and musically too, you have to remember also, you know, we're getting in, I mean, hip-hop has been around for a while and everything, but I mean, NWA is like, what, 88, 89-ish?
Who?
So it's like this, like, NWA?
I'm not familiar, what does that stand for?
No whites allowed.
you're not allowed to have a prepared response when I try to put you on the spot like that.
Well, it helps me because, no joke, that is what my mom thought NWA stood for.
Really?
And honestly, to this day, I don't think my mom is fully aware. We watch Straight Outta Compton, and then every time they're like, "What? Why are you calling each other NWA?" And then I just piped in, "No whites allowed!" It's just in my own edited version.
You just recorded over it, like, it was on a, you had the VHS copy.
Yeah. And it's the guy that's playing Dr. Dre, he's like, "Why are we called NWA? Because no whites allowed! That's why."
It's a spot-on Dr. Dre impression. You know, you sound like you forgot about that, man.
"Hey, Snoop Dogg, you want to record the Chronic with me?" "Yeah, sure, Dr. Dre." "All right, here we go. And a 1, 2, 3, 4.
And a 1, and a 2, and a, oh boy, me and my friends here spitting rhymes. Smoking and it depends on if we're gonna have a good time. And let's do one more fancy rhyme. It's my boy Snoop Doggy Dog, and we are here burning a fire log. This fire log is heating up my hands, but don't worry, I got my bands." Yep.
Drop those bars.
I'm so glad that I have the editing capabilities in this podcast.
Don't you edit that out, because you know why? What you were doing right there? You know what you were? You're pretty fly for a white guy.
Oh, and it's so in. Oh, just like, oh, the Ouroboros is sniffing its own behind.
Also, your vocabulary, I've never known you to use these big words. This whole time talking to you, your vocabulary is immensely provocative.
Wow, your vernacular is lacking. I might doubt the verisimilitude of any diploma you may procure.
Okay, put your word of the day calendar away.
Okay,
and
sorry,
all the sheets you've saved over the year,
okay,
and talk to me like a goddamn human.
Okay, all right, calendar's away.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
It's
that picture was stupid on the cover, too.
I've begone the calendar.
Your Far Side calendar?
Yeah. I loved Far Side so much, dude. Okay, if we're going to talk about, like, peak, like, for the Offspring, Far Side and Calvin and Hobbes, when that shit was happening, that was the 90s, too. Yeah, dude. Gary Larson and Bill Watterson. Prime. I love that.
Great,
I used to have so many Calvin and Hobbes and Far Side books. Like, I had a shelf in my bookshelf that was just like 6 hardcover Calvin and Hobbes books, then a bunch of like Far Side collections. And you could just like read that stuff over and over again and just watch all the, like, you open the Far Side book. You're like, all right, what are these cows going to say? Ah, these are funny cows. You open the Calvin Hobbes book. You're like, what's this tiger going to do? Oh, it's a funny tiger.
Whenever I hear Far Side, I instantly think of, like, you know, the cow patterns, you know, just instantly, just like right in my mind. Calvin and Hobbes, I always get confused. I'm aware it's the boy and the tiger.
It is the boy and the tiger.
Right? The boy and the tiger. I always got him and Peabody and Sherman confused, because he's the boy and the dog.
Right. But one of them is vastly superior to the other, and that is Calvin and Hobbes.
Calvin and Hobbes
is fantastic. You don't see Mr. Peabody pissing on Chrysler on the back of people's Fords.
Oh, that's Calvin. Wow. See, and that's how far he's gone.
Yeah.
Where, like, I saw Calvin the other day on the back of a white-lifted truck peeing on Biden and Kamala's Name,
of course,
classic Grover Beach.
That's such like a fucking terrible thing to make. Calvin would have totally voted for Joe Biden, and could, because 100%. By this point Calvin's like 18, like 30 years old or something like that. Like Calvin's a voting age. That motherfucker would like quote like communist manifesto shit and like talk about how like the bourgeoisie, and you're just like, damn dog, okay. Damn, Calvin.
It's like, I wanted Bernie Sanders, but I'll settle for Biden, I guess.
Yeah, for real. That's, I mean, there's a lot of us that feel that way. Don't want to get political on this show! but I definitely feel that way.
You know, just try something new.
So this next song is actually, you know what?
Is Bernie Sanders' favorite song?
It very well may be, because it's about jail. It's about somebody getting away with something for a long, long time and then suddenly facing the consequences of their actions and being forced into jail, which, you know, could happen to some certain authority figures, maybe, you know, who knows? Who knows? Who knows?
Hopefully.
But this song is fantastic. I very much like it. And it is called Walla Walla. One and two and three and four and one. It's got a very fun intro. Yeah. You can already tell it's a fun song.
Yep.
So good. It's just about, you know, as you can tell, somebody getting fucked, you know, finally facing the results of their crimes. And Walla Walla is Walla Walla Washington.
Oh, Walla Walla Washington, yes.
Walla Walla?
Walla Walla Washington. If you're a Microbiglia fan, it's Walla Walla Washington.
Well, you if you're listening to the Offspring song called Walla Walla, and you've heard Walla Walla for your entire life. I've never heard Mike Birbiglia say Waya Waya.
You've never listened. We don't need to go down that. This is also a weird thing of playing the Offspring and me trying to explain to you a Mike Birbiglia bit. Because that is nothing.
Oh, is it a joke he makes?
It's a joke he makes, yes, because he has left this whole thing about, like, he stayed at...
I literally thought that you were just, like, saying, no, it's pronounced Waya Waya. And I was like, there's no way! And you're like, Mike Birbiglia, and I was like...
The way you looked at me, too, when I said that.
Yeah, it's like, how... What? It's... No!
What is...
This song is about jail, obviously, going to jail. And it's like, it's very fun. It's a very fun song, obviously. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Like, it's very, but it's also very funny, like, oh, you were trying to run away from the cops, but under your arm was a VCR, so, like, you couldn't get away. It's very funny.
They've got a great sense of humor, and I love that.
And then I also like the end. It does this little, like, breakdown thing. Yeah. It has this cool, like, little, like, fun breakdown part where, like, it's, like, a little skit in the middle of the song. So, like... It's like playing the song, it's like da 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 da, and you know, and it goes to the chorus and everything, and it goes to this little interlude part. I really like that part of the song, but it's a really fun song.
This is cool. You know, I'm gonna backtrack just a skosh on the Pretty Fly for a White Guy thing, because now that we're getting more into the album, and especially with the intro, the welcome song, and then like some of these other things with like the weird kind of like voice thing, and then there's like that little break of like the conversation type of thing, it's meshing better now. I'm understanding it more, like it's kind of like an overall reoccurring thing that's going on that makes it make more sense, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely, it's not, once you hear the whole album, it's nice that it's not the only kind of lighthearted funny song.
Yes. Like, if it was the one song where it was like, oh, I mean, you know, all that stuff, yeah. And everything else is just like, duka, 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 you'd be like, that, I don't know, but at least, you know, it's in there.
Yeah. And then there's another song.
They listened to it the first time.
Yeah, there's
they're like, no, you need more voice.
I forgot to say that She's Got Issues was another single off of the album, that last song that we listened to.
Ah, okay.
But, yeah, it is nice that it's not the only lighthearted song, but there is another song that is coming up later that is also very lighthearted, and you're going to be like, I've heard this song as well, and okay, I recognize, okay. I know what you're talking about. And so let's go ahead and move on to the next song, which is a fucking great song, which I don't understand why it's as early in the album as it is. Like, it feels, the name of the song is The End of the Line, so you kind of like, mm-hmm, would put it at, mm-hmm, you know, you feel like it's at the end, and it feels like an album, yes, closer, much more so. I feel like the album definitely tapers off at the end, and I feel like it could have had a very strong closer like The End of the Line, but it kind of doesn't, but regardless, this is track 9, The End of the Line. Very bass centric. When the siren's flash is gone, and we're left to carry on. I love that the bass drum that you can hear, that just like the, mm-hmm, pounding, like, like, it's just so perfect.
Yeah, this is a great quality of a album closer.
Yeah, right? You'd think that, like, that would be, like, so good, like, and, like, don't, you know, and have, like, a kind of, like, a message at the end of it, too.
Yeah.
But it has this cool, like, breakdown in the middle of it, with kind of, like, everything kind of, like, does feedback and weird sounds. And especially when you listen to the actual song, like, the stereo-ness of it, it's, mm-hmm, like, goes between your headphones a lot, like, but you have to listen, cool, to the stereo, like, version of it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's a very cool, you know.
That's cool, that distorted, feedback-y, mm-hmm, guitar part there is fun.
Yeah, it's just, like, so, super open, and the drums are kind of, like, you know, keeping the beat, and then just, like, cool, ethereal sounds and stuff.
It's just weird how, like, the drum beat is like, but like, you know, musically, like, in your soul, you just feel that 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, you know, but it's just, I don't know.
Well, he's keeping it with that bass drum, like, and it's still, and once he goes right back into it, it's just, like, so perfect. And that's the hardest part, is just, like, is that get that the right du-ta instead of ta-do.
Yeah.
Like, that timing is so impossible. And the drummer for this band is so good at it. That was The End of the Line, which I think should have been the closer. I think it should have been moved down. Mm. But that's just me. We're not going to resequence the album.
I agree so far. Yes.
Now, I said that I wasn't going to say what my favorite song is on this album.
Okay.
That being said, this next track is very good. It is 2 minutes and 4 seconds, so it is the shortest actual song on the album, and okay, it is very aptly named.
Is this your favorite song on the album?
Not gonna say that. It is very aptly named, No Breaks.
Thank you. One moment, please.
Just, like, directly into the music. Just, like, so...
Yeah.
Just laying awake, I don't give a shit. Like, so good.
Oh, that's good. I like that, especially for the vibe of the album. So many, like, build-ups or, like, little... Yeah. Just go right into it.
You know I got no breaks. and that guitar like
this could be a great like coming on stage song so for good. You for comedy. It's like coming on like the line I have no breaks.
When you were saying the kids aren't alright would be a good like opening song, I was like, oh, wait for no breaks. But like it's just like so it's just like fucking pounding and it's got that do-da-da-da-da-da-da like the whole time and it's just like and it's like I said 2 minutes long.
So many drumsticks gets used during a show.
Yeah. So good.
It's so fun how many riffs they use in a song. Like I feel like every like they'll use like three riffs in a song and I feel like all those riffs could be their own song. But they're just like confining it into one, which like makes their sound.
Yeah, exactly. Like that's I couldn't have said it better. They just take like a bunch of riffs that could be their own song and stick them together and into like they're like, oh, these are in the same key. Let's fucking do it. I very much enjoy that song. This next song, this is track 11. We're almost done. This is the other single from the album. So we've had so far Pretty Fly for a White Guy, The Kids Aren't All Right,
okay, and so, She's Got Issues. Wait, okay, you're speeding through it real quick. Hold up. So the album, the first single was Pretty Fly for a White Guy. That's what's getting our attention as a consumer. That single's coming out, okay, blah. Second single.
We're not going to talk about that because that is what this is. Yeah.
What we're about to play.
So this
okay,
is the second
perfect.
Single
okay,
from the
so...
album before The Kids Aren't All Right and She's Got Issues, which were the other two singles from the album. So
okay. So listeners, let's put ourselves in a space right now. Let's just like really like take this in together. It is 1998. Pretty Fly for a White Guy is one of the most popular songs in the country.
It's the single release of 1999.
Oh, 1999.
Yeah,
okay.
March of 99.
Okay, so we like the song, but it's like, should we go buy
we're
the
CD? We're preparing for Y2K.
And we're preparing for Y2K, so this might be the last album we ever buy. do we want to spend the $17 on the CD, which, by the way, we can't buy singles yet. It's 1998. Go fuck yourself. and so, here's a new Offspring single. Okay, this is going to be the determination if I buy this album. I'm saving up my change. I'm getting the coins out of the couch cushions. Play it. Am I buying the album? It's 1998.
I just heard the new Temple of the Dog track, and I'm really fond of that. I just gotta see which album I'm gonna buy.
It's either this or Temple of the Dog, man. Like I got $17. I can only get one, man.
I heard Pretty Fly for a White Guy. We'll see what happens. This song is called Why Don't You Get a Job?
My friend's got a girlfriend, and he hates that bitch. He tells me
Nick legitimately just I in this Discord conversation that we are having right now, I just watched Nick deflate. Like I just watched his he was like he shrunk 2 inches and his shoulders just fell in like a dying sun. He just collapsed in on himself as soon as this started.
Oh my god, that is a perfect way to explain because I do that a lot in life. I do deflate. I do that movement with my shoulders and like just my overall just like.
So this is this is Why Don't You Get a Job? And everyone
I'm not gonna
remembers
lie, though.
This.
Everyone loved. I heard the start and I was like, not this song. But you know what? Once it gets going, I'm like, it's a great song. Mom, can I borrow $5? I got 10 for the new Offspring album. Can I get $5? Why $5? Just like come over here, listen to this song, because this song is making me buy this album.
I gotta get it now. The good thing, so this like it starts off kind of bad, like where he's like, my friend's got a girlfriend and he hates that bitch, and it's like very misogynistic, but it turns it around halfway through because it's literally just about like people in relationships who are like their significant other is totally dependent on them for fucking everything. So it does like a male version. Let's see if we can find the male version. There it is.
Also, this is the song that is played at, that is requested at middle school dances at the time. where it's like you go up to the dean and it's like, can you play Why Don't You Get a Job? And they're like, well, we only play the edited version. It's like, that's fine. But everyone, while it's playing, screams out the right words, bitch, dick, all that kind of stuff.
My same thing. My friend's got a girlfriend, man. He hates that. Walk up.
We're from the same generation where we went to so many high school dances, and like the peak of the dance was when they played Get Low.
No.
By Lil Jon.
You are so far from what the peak of the dance was, Nick.
Why?
The peak of the dance was when they played Cotton Eye Joe, my friend. That was the peak of every...
You did go to a Tascadero, didn't you? Oh my
every
God.
Middle school dance, they would play Cotton Eye Joe, and people would lose their shit, Nicholas. They would lose their shit.
Of course they did, because you're in Atascabama. Oh, you're in all the stupid names that we have in the Central Coast. Hi, we're from the San Luis Obispo County. No, that makes so much sense. No. See, at Laguna Middle School, at San Luis Obispo High School.
Oh, shit.
We fucked.
Okay.
We went hard. So when through the window, and instead of like the what's the edited version? Skeet skeet. It's like you know, we were all just like yelling all the stuff. And,
that's not the edited version. They
sweat
say
right
skeet,
down
skeet
my balls.
The unedited version. Skeet has come.
No, it's the sweat right down my balls. All these men, skeet skeet, motherfucker.
Yeah,
skeet 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 skeet. There it was. But like you know, like the edited version. Then we'd all, you motherfucker. that is to loop back around. You Cotton Eye Joe fuck. You. This is the song at the middle school dance where it's like, we're going to all yell out bitch at the same time. We're going to yell out dick. We know the real words.
Happening. I heard, I don't know if you can confirm this, I heard that Cotton Eye Joe is about STD testing. I heard that it is about, you know,
is
how
that
you
around
get swabbed then? With a Q-tip. Like they swab your they swab it. And then, if it hadn't been for Cotton Eye Joe, I'd have been married a long time ago. But then he found out that he had an STD, and then he didn't do it? I don't know. I heard it, and I'm just reporting. This is secondhand. This is hearsay.
That was a gunshot sound that we just heard. Because
cool.
I am blowing my mind if that is the truth, because... What are we titling this episode now? Just like weird, dirty illusions in music, where it's like we got Limp Bizkit, we got Pearl Jam, and now we got STDs Joe. I mean Cotton Eye Joe.
STDs
I'm sorry.
Joe.
That was the original title of the song. It was like, I got this new song. It's called STD Joe.
If it hadn't been for STDs Joe,
I was like, there's just I need more C's and T's in the title.
If it hadn't been for Cunt Joe.
I was like, oh, I got you right away. And the label's like, no, that's not what we're saying. Less U and N's and more C's and T's. Dot your T's and slash your I's.
Just like Cotton Eye Joe. Slashing the I's. So we are now like on the downslope of the album. This is the last three tracks. Americana, mm-hmm. I would say, is
ooh,
the last...
Ooh.
This next song... did you want to say something?
No, we're on Why Don't You Give a Job. No, we're good. We're good. Yeah. You're... Oh, I'm trying... I am... This is why I hate, also, real quick, what just happened right now is a sign of why I hate the state that we are in as a society, mm-hmm. which is... I wanted you to scroll down. I can see this. I can see Rick's screen on our little Discord chat. I wanted him to scroll down. So instead of trying to communicate it with my own finger, I try to scroll my laptop down. So that way it's like, no, there. And that's why have you done that? I was shown a picture, like a physical picture recently. Like when I was a child, I was like, ah, man, what am I wearing? And like literally I tried to enlarge the physical photo.
I was just going to say that.
With my thing, I was like, oh, what is that? I was like, oh my God, that isn't a thing.
I have tried
too
to
deep
pinch
in the matrix
to zoom
now.
Like, I have tried to do that mm-hmm. on pictures. I'm like, oh.
On real objects.
Yep. This,
yeah,
it's
that
the end
is
of
where
times.
We've come. So thanks. Thanks, Mark Apple.
Yeah,
thanks,
Mark Apple.
Thanks, Steve. Why don't you get a job?
Thanks, Steve, in employment.
Thanks a lot, COVID. Thanks a lot, Bin Laden.
Good job, Obama.
Thanks a lot, Bin Laden, and good job, Obama. Will never go out of style.
No, it's
in our generation, never.
And hopefully, fuck Trump is the same.
you surprised?
I know, right?
Real quick question:
yeah.
What is your feelings on songs that are the same title as the album?
I feel like very rarely does an artist name their album after the best song on the album. And I feel like it also, it kind of, I don't know, I'm back and forth on it because, there are a lot of albums that obviously aren't called a song title at all. Albums that are named after the song. This next song is obviously the name of the album. I'll come out and say it. I don't think it's the best song on the album. It's a great name for an album, obviously. Americana is a very good name for an album because it's very evocative. And when it is like saying all these different things, like the Walla Walla is the jail thing, and then No Break says I don't give a shit, and then it's very like aggressive, and then saying, you know, this is Americana right now, is being fucking angry. Or, you know, being pretty fly for a white guy.
Would you agree? I feel like there's just like a part of me, like when I like see an album, I haven't listened to the new album, and you're looking through the songs, and it's like the same, there's a song title that's the same as the album. In my heart, and I want to believe it, but it's never usually true, but that should be the best song on the album. That should encompass what the album is. Would you say this...
I agree to an extent.
Would you say this hits in the realm of that? Is Americana the song a good representation of what this album is?
Well, you know what? I will say this. Why don't we let the listener decide?
Ooh.
And if you think that this is a great representation of this album, if you've listened to the whole thing, and you think that this is the song that sums up the album, let us know. I won't give my opinion either way.
As you usually
and
do.
And Nick, I encourage you to do the same.
I will.
Very good, very good. And this song is obviously Americana, and it is track 12 on the album. And it is playing now.
This is already amazing. Oh.
Oh, it's a good song. Regardless of how you think it sums up the album.
That is so Sabbath.
Or anything.
That is the opening chord of Iron Man. With the effect almost.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very evocative of Sabbath. And what's very cool is what's going to happen very shortly. Got a nice long intro, you know. If it's the name of the album, it's got to be a pretty epic song.
Exactly.
Like, they got to like build it up. So I mean, this is, you know, pretty long for an intro. It's been like almost a minute, but it happens.
Oh, okay, that was nice.
Yeah, it comes out of nowhere.
Like I said earlier, always thinking about in concerts and everything. I can't remember the song. I'm going to try to scroll down on my computer. Nope, that's not how that works.
Americana.
Was it? It was, I think it was Have You Ever. I was saying that's a great opener for the concert.
Oh, yeah.
But this is, again, another great opener, especially on the Americana tour that, you know, I'm sure they did and everything, but, like, again, lights go dark. Ooh, oh, here they come. They come out, also just boom, 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 bam.
Just, like, one instrument at a time coming in, like,
yes,
drums
first, exactly.
Then, like, the bass.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, just, like, oh, that is a great, great opener.
Yeah, and then when it just, like, goes into the song, it's just, like, you hear like the guitar, like, let's see if we can get into that little guitar. All about my dream, it's a just that.
That was right into it, dude. Great slide on that. And it's super cool because, like, for the album, this intro is very not the Offspring. And so you're kind of like, what's happening here? Little elements of Sabbath, a little bit of this and that and everything. But then when it comes back into it, it's full Offspring, which is great.
Yeah, exactly.
Boo-doo, 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 boo-doo. Yeah. It's just great. Okay, I like this.
And this song is about, like, so one of the lines. Give me fast food, 4x4s, strip malls, like, it's just all about, like, you know, the things that have made America, America, that aren't so great. It's a good song. It's definitely a good song.
It was a great line because I've really been milking and like accepting and understanding the line of I only work here at my job recently. Where it's like, well, like, what's this and what's that and what? How do you do this? It's like, ma'am, I only work here. Okay, I bring the pizza out. You order it first. I bring it out. And then you pay me. That's
well,
kind of...
Well, why is this $20? Because it fucking is.
Exactly, yes. Well, why did you guys move over here when everything seemed to be good at the last location? Look, I got told to show up at one address one day, and I came to the new address the next day, okay? Do you want pepperoni or not?
That's it. That's all I can tell you, honestly.
I love that.
Yeah, I just work here is a fucking mantra, to be honest. Like,
which,
that's
like, it takes, like, very... Yes, very... very deep level minimum wage workers, as I'm sure we are together, understand where it's like, I just work here, okay? Just don't ask me anything.
I don't know anything about anything, please. I am a robot.
Well, why is the constructions working on the corner over there when really we need the speed bumps? Look, I just work here. Do you want spaghetti with meatballs or not?
Oh, you know, because I asked them to. Because I called them and I was like, can you please come here and fuck this woman's day up? Can you please put a speed bump all over this road? And can you please make it so that we are extra slow
because
today?
I'm trying to talk to this woman that will be coming in here to ask me these questions.
Yeah.
Why don't you get a job?
To make sure it happens. Thanks. All right. We're on the last two tracks of the album. This track 13 is totally outside. It doesn't even feel
this is the black sheep
like
of the album.
A song on this album. This is like the how I said at the beginning how like a lot of songs used to have a long song at the end that was like the opus.
Okay.
Where it was like
okay.
Different. Instruments and different,
so,
you know, segments
so can
and stuff
you do
like that.
Me a favor because this is one of the things I use Spotify. I love Spotify. Spotify, if you're listening, love a good sponsor. But this is why I hate Spotify.
Spotify-sponsor us.
Spotify always goes with the remastered, 10-year anniversary releases. So, like, my question here as I'm seeing the track listing on the original album was Pretty Fly for a White Guy reprise. Supposed to be the album closer. Can you confirm that on the CD when you listened to it?
When I had the CD, I do not remember the Pretty Fly reprise. I don't remember that happening at all. I remember listening to the whole album, and I honestly remember it having 13 tracks.
Yes.
That being said, I honestly didn't remember the last song on this album very much anyway.
Because it's so long.
So it could, because it's long and because it's different and because I didn't really listen to it very much when I got when we had the album.
Well, you were
like
7,
that.
8, 9, 10.
But when I was 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, we had, you know, only so much. But this, it's.
I just want to throw this out to Spotify. I am a purist. I would love it if you release albums like the original release and then the remaster, like all the bonus track things, because I hate it where I'm like, I'm trying to listen. Like earlier this year, I got into Paul Simon's album Graceland. Very important, very amazing album and everything. But Spotify was always like being like, here's the 2015 re-release with all the demos and the outtakes. It's like, no, I haven't even listened to the album, Spotify. Give me a choice of the original, the way the artist wanted. If I want to get deeper, then I can go into your, you know, re-release type of shit. Wikipedia's exactly. telling me that Pay the Man, track 13 that we're about to listen to, is the original release. So,
yeah. I remember it definitely more than I remembered the reprise.
Yes,
happening.
So this is the true... Well, listen to the reprise, or the reprise, whatever. The reprise, but I just note...
The represent.
The Offspring wanted this to be... This is the true last song.
Yeah, this is the closer
this
on
the
album.
The true closer. Fuck off Spotify. We'll listen to the next one later. But sponsor us.
This is Pay the Man. What is this, a Beatles song? Very, like, weird vibe.
Or if I was the dad, listen to it. Oh my god, is this a Beatles song I've never heard of?
Very ethereal, very, like, open, spacey. Very, The Doors, reminiscent
a lot,
of The Doors.
Yeah, a lot of elements coming in here. The cleanest guitars on the whole album, wow.
Yeah. So let's go a little bit further into the song. We've got this little, like, Eastern-y, Indian-sounding, like... And it gets big.
Dang. I can already feel like there's, like there's a sense of, like, true Offspring fans where it's like, oh my god, they're playing Pay the Man in full. Like that, like that's the sign of the like the good Offspring shows where it's like, oh, you know, they played, you know, yeah. Pretty Fly and Walla Walla and all that, but it's like, you know what they ended with before they came out their encore? Pay the Man in full. It's like, wait, what?
Dude, we got Pay the Man. Can you believe it? Trust me, I'm a Fish fan. I know all about.
Oh, total. Oh, 100%. And I'm that way with my bands and all that. But it's a real thing. I'm not trying to say, like, they're stupid or anything. Like, that. I feel like there is a thing where it's like they played Pay the Man. Like, oh, yeah, they did when I saw him too. No. The whole intro. Oh, shit. They didn't just go straight into the song?
Whole fucking thing,
oh,
man. Nah, bro. it's good. You know, it's got these different parts. This is a great Offspring sounding song. This is, I would say, like the main part of the song. You know, it's like the song portion of it. And then it ends in this, like, you know, kind of acoustic-y thing, and then it goes. It's like it's almost a completely different song. And then it just ends. But it's really weird for an album closer because it's not like, I don't know, it just doesn't feel like a closer to me. It feels, I mean, yeah, I get that, you know, at the end of the album there was supposed to be this long song or whatever, and they did that a lot of albums, but this doesn't feel like mm-hmm, that song mm-hmm, to me. Mm-hmm. It feels like it's just a long song with like a long intro that doesn't necessarily fulfill that void.
I understand and I agree. I think it would have been perfect if it was a non-listed song on the CD. You buy the CD, there's 12 songs on it,
like,
and all of a sudden
track
13 comes on. You're like, wait, what? There's no expectations type of thing.
Yeah.
It's a great non-listed track on there. But it's just, it's not too out there, but it's definitely out there for what the rest of the album was. Very experimental.
Right, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And I don't know that I've heard another Offspring song that's as experimental.
Really?
As that. Like, it's very, very, uses different instrumentation and you know, the different time signatures and, like I said, the different sections mm-hmm. of it coming mm-hmm. together, almost like it was, like, written independently and then, you know, I don't know. It's very strange.
I would love it.
And it's a weird way to end the
album. I don't
know
if this is a real... Of course, this probably isn't a real thing. But I like the idea of, like, the labels. Like, we're going to put Pretty Fly for a White Guy on in the album. And that's the first single. And they're like, no, we don't want to do that. It's like, well, we're going to do that. It's like, well, then we won't release the album. It's like, well, what can we do for it? It's like, we want Pay the Man on it. It's like, we heard it. It's really weird. It's like, we're not releasing the album without it.
We want 8 minutes at the end of the album.
Fine, we'll put it on track five, the one that no one will listen to. No. Closer.
No, sorry. Track five is Kids Aren't All Right. That's already a single, motherfucker. You got to take it now.
Take that nap.
But yeah, I don't know. Pay the Man, I don't think that there's necessarily a song on this album that is bad.
No.
They're a good band, and it's a good album. I don't think that there's anything I can listen to, but like, this song sucks. But Pay the Man is definitely... probably my least favorite song on the album.
And I see why.
And yeah, but I mean, it's also kind of weird because I normally would like something like that that's like longer. I listen to a lot of like longer music like that that's kind of like noodly and weird. And so I don't know that it's because it's long or because it's noodly. I just think that the song section of it doesn't fully pay off the intro section of it, if that makes sense.
Here's my question. Is it because, like you said, you know, you're into that kind of these kinds of songs and music and everything? Is it because it's The Offspring and it's not like their vibe? Like, if like you saw like this was like, oh, Pay the Man by Grateful Dead, would you be like, oh, okay, yeah, classic Dead or something? You know, is it because it's just kind of a little out there for the band?
Maybe because like I've been saying the whole time, it's like, oh, this song is like 3 minutes long, like this song is like 2.5, like it's a good like fucking like bam 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 song. And I think maybe that is what I expect from Offspring. And when it's this longer song, I don't know that Offspring for me personally works in a longer song setting. I think that Offspring is much more about these like quick like bam 2.5 minutes, 3 minutes of like a fucking in your face punk song that is going to be like, you know, high energy or like have some, you know, interesting stuff or whatever. But I don't think that the song portion of Pay the Man is as interesting as the intro wants you to believe.
True. I get that. I totally do. And I would love to hear from like some Offspring hardcore fans of where Pay the Man falls in their list. Like, would they agree that it's a little too out there, but it's not a bad song, but it's like, you know, whatever. Is Pay the Man what I have really discovered this past year, which is like my beer song is what I call it, which is
you're
at the concert, you know, you're seeing The Offspring, they played Feelings, they played, you know, Fly for a White Guy, they played Walla Walla. It's like, all right, we're gonna play Pay the Man. It's like, all right, I'm going to go to the bathroom and beer run. You need a beer? You need a beer? Okay, I'll be back. You know, it's the beer song. I'm okay.
You always got to have your pee song. Like, yeah, I've always referred to it as the pee song, the song that you're like, all right, I can go to the bathroom during this one. Like, I can miss this song. Get a beer, exactly. Just, like, take a break for a second, get out of the crowd, and, like, you know, maybe it's not, like, the worst song, but it's just, like, a song that you're
I'm
like,
fine.
This one I'm fine
and
with.
And also, you got 8 minutes.
Yeah, you got enough time to,
and
like,
they might jam.
Almost get
you don't
to the
know.
Bathroom.
They might really get into that intro a little bit.
They might just take it out there. Oh, shit, what is that? Oh, my God, it's Brad Paisley's coming out to jam with Offspring.
Beer? Who needs
what?
A beer? Who
oh, my God.
Really, you're going to leave right now as Brad Paisley is coming to the stage? Two beers?
Dude, Jim James from My Morning Jacket? What the fuck? Oh, God, yeah, this is going to be a 15, 16 minutes.
Oh, that's cool. Ah, shit, it's gonna be 17 minutes then. All right, never mind. Beer. I'm gonna finish a beer. Pee. Go get the beer.
I'm gonna go take a shit.
Oh, shit, it's Jim James? Okay, I got time to take a shit then. I like that. Not saying that Jim James is shit. All right,
well, I think we're at the very end of this. Yeah, absolutely. We're at the very end of the album. All we have left is this reprise. And what I think we'll do is I'll press play and we'll just kind of do like a little outro thing and, you know, wrap this thing up while this plays, because it's not really a song. Like, it's a minute long. And as soon as I press play on it, you'll be like, oh, is this what this is? And I can guarantee you that's what it is the whole time. So this is the Pretty Fly reprise, track 14, on the special edition, I guess, because it was on the original, of Americana. So this is this. Yep. They just, I imagine they hired a mariachi band.
Oh, this is for the,
yeah, this is
for the, yeah, it's kids, the mariachi version.
Exactly. And then there's, they still have the old guy who pops in. Yep, pops in and everything. That is Pretty Fly reprise.
Oh, so God.
What did you think, Nick? Like you said, you've never heard Offspring really before. You've heard a couple of songs before, I'm sure, but that album really brings back a lot of memories for me. And like I said, I have a lot of feelings associated with it, just of like being a kid and you know, enjoying an album. When you're a kid, you didn't really have favorite music really yet. I remember the first album I ever got was my mom gave me Alanis Morissette's Jagged Little Pill.
Wow, that's a dirty first album.
Right? Damn. But it's so good. And it's I don't think she knew that one of the songs was about blowing Dave Coulier in a theater. But, I mean, you know, Uncle Joey means different things to different people. And for me, it was definitely imagining him getting a beat.
Yeah, getting a full house in Alanis' mouth. Yeah.
Would you go down on it and a theater? But it's a dope record, and so when I got, you know, when I started listening to this, I had no preconceptions of punk or anything, and I just thought it was fantastic music, and it meant a lot to me. So what do you think?
It's good. I like it. I get it. That's always kind of my thing. My big question and like kind of my concern and like the answer I'm looking for whenever I'm listening to a band that is. Has a important status as Offspring does. You know, always heard the name. I understand. You know, always high praise for all those kinds of bands and everything. But I'm always like kind of wary, where it's like, ah, man, I'm not gonna get it. I'm not gonna like it. What if I don't like it? That's even worse. You know? But I get it, and that's what's great. It's moshable. It's fun. It's high energy, and it's got like it's got the right amount of angst. It's not. Too preachy of like trying to like a 38-year-old being like, oh, come on kids, don't parents suck, you know? It's not like anything that's like trying. It's just like, you know, feelings and like, you know, the girls and we're not all right and just like loud music and just like none of the I love, you know, when you listen to a song multiple times and the lyrics change every time, or you understand more, you're like, oh, whoa, that is alluding to this, or like, that's, you know, trying to like, you know, set up this type of thing or that or whatever. But like, I love that their lyrics are just so straightforward where you don't have to like, you know, there's times where I'm just like, I just want to hear what the song's about, you know? I love you,
right.
You don't love me.
I don't have
me.
To parse
exactly.
Through your poetry.
Where we're trying to like dissect, like, it's like, well, you know, the tree is a symbolism of love, and she's the lumberjack, and it's hard as the tree. Uh-oh, a puppy just came in.
Uh-oh, we got a pooch on screen. Oh, hello, pooch.
Don't call my girlfriend.
Hi, buddy.
Anyway.
Sorry.
But anyway, I like it, and you know what? I'm going to go ahead and go to the next level of it and say that I will, in the future, listen to more Offspring. Because I enjoyed it.
Oh, wow. Yes,
I will.
You hear that, Offspring? I am essentially a marketing director for you. So
I'm drinking the Offspring punch right now.
Hell yeah. Get that cool kids aid. There's got to be something in there. So I never said what my favorite song is on the album, but I think I made it pretty clear. My favorite song is Pretty Fly for a White Guy. It's the no. My favorite song is obviously No Breaks. I think that is just like so punchy and so just like when I was a kid, the fact that he said I don't give a shit just really resonated with me, and I was just like, it just meant a lot to me at that point in my life and still means a lot to me. I would say that's my favorite song on the album. What do you have a favorite song on this album?
I mean, honestly, like Americana really, really hit hard. And Have You Ever.
Yes.
It's just like, especially, I'm just like a sucker for like off of the welcome intro of it.
Right?
I love a good like kind of like weird like, oh, we're over here, like, you know, distraction, and all of a sudden just boom.
Yeah,
you know, coming in
just
with,
hits
with
you right there.
Yeah. So that was good. And I mean, I might go get pizza right now and play Why Don't You Get a Job as I like go over there just blaring it out, being like, yep, I'm that guy right now. No, it's not on the radio. It's Spotify. I chose
no, yeah.
to
this
play
is on my
this
playlist.
Song.
I searched for this. All right. Well, I think that we've gone pretty long for our first episode, or first, you know,
yes.
I think we'll save your favorite album for next time. Do you want to give a teaser of what your favorite album, or not favorite album, obviously, but what your album is going to be?
Well, you know what? I'm going to be honest with you. I had and still do have an album that I'm going to do. I think I might change it a little bit just through our conversations.
Oh, wow.
It was going to be something a little bit from the 60s era, but I don't know. I might go a little bit more into the early 2000s.
Wow. I think that's a pretty good tease.
Yeah. So it's either soft rock 60s or hardcore heavy metal early 2000s. I'm not sure.
Wow. I mean, that... I'm certainly looking forward to this next episode. I don't know about
it
you
guys. It makes you want to listen, huh?
It makes me want to listen. And of course, I mean, this is the end of the first episode, but I got to thank you, Nick, for doing this with me. You are my co-host. We are co-hosts together in this journey through this podcast. And of course, I have to thank Pale Blue Dot for our theme for you off of Kingdom, Phylum, Class, Order, Family, Genus, Species. Out now. Go get that album. It's a great album and it's a great song. And that's all I have to say. Do you have any final words, Nick?
I love music. I dig music.
Genius. I love it. Love it. Nope, that's all you need to say. I love music. Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard it from the best, you've heard it from the rest, and now you've heard it from the chest. That's right, Nick the Chest Malizia. We have been Nick Malizia and Rick Storr. Thank you for listening. This has been Spin Doctors. See you next time. Bye!